that we've always done up to this point more of a user-centric, role-based access control type of security model, in which you've seen almost most of the breaches occur because what happens in that model is I'm a user, I stick in my CAC card, whatever, I authenticate, and then I receive a token back. And really how the authorization piece is done is possession of a token, right? Which means that any interception of that token, any spoofing, any of those things that that token needs to be presented to access APIs, data itself, all I have to do is have possession. Which is where we see most of the breaches. People put up, credentials in GitHub or, man-in-the-middle attacks or these type of things. And so what this talk about is about is we have this problem coming up with our Drupal adversary, and we have this technology emerging, which is we're going to have to do thousands of drones, right? And we have thousands of AI collaborative agents, and we have automation, from software secure supply chains to just normal optimization of processes that we want to have less people and more optimization so we can do more things with less people. And so the idea here is that in order to stay up with that, typically how identity is done is if I'm dealing with a drone or I'm dealing with an agent of some sort, I create a user account and then I call it a drone account or I call it a system account or I call it whatever, but at the end of the day, it's still a secret sharing, passing of credentials, ownership of the credential, or possession of the credential. And so what we need is a shift from that sort of focus into true identity of whatever it is the calling function down to sort of process levels. And if you think about it, it makes sense. And if you're looking at it from a basic understanding of everything has to run somewhere. So we have a starting point, right? Everything runs on silicon, right? And so we have a way to start building root trust up from the silicon all the way up into the software and then be able to create digital certificates that are the identity of that particular device, of those particular workloads that run on that device, and then those things can then exchange and attest in a mutually authentication sort of way that this API that's calling me, or this thing that's calling me over here, this process that's calling me over here, has a provenance of the digital footprint that it has that I can attest before I even establish the TLS communication between it and myself. And so the idea here is that if I'm going to do this, I have to create something that the device has unique about it. So typically you fall back to the true random number generation, TRNG, right? And so the things that give us these on silicon are tamper prevention modules. So you have these little chipsets that have quantum weights that are fundamentally different, unique from each other. They can generate that sort of random entropy as a first sort of kernel entropy. And then from there, you have a specific configuration of that device that comes from the manufacturer that says, you bought this much RAM, it's on this sort of motherboard, it has this processor on it, and it has a manufacturing certificate that comes with that. So now I have two pieces of unique stuff for that, that particular device itself. So I start with that, and I create a digital identity with that, and I sign it with what NIST just dropped on their 203, 204, 205 post-quantum resistant algorithms, Kyber and the lithium. And inside of those, the lithium is the one that does the digital cert that's quantum resistant. So now I create a quantum resistant identity for the particular device. The next thing I do is, let's say I'm going to deploy Kubernetes on it, right? Everyone knows Kubernetes, right? So I have Kubernetes. Kubernetes itself, every deployment of Kubernetes has very, very unique characteristics of it that I can then draw a digital identity for the Kubernetes cluster. And that Kubernetes cluster then has its own digital cert that's then added to that provenance of, so now I'm at the device, now I'm up to the Kubernetes, which is layer 4. And then the very next thing is now I'm going to deploy a workload, and that workload has unique characteristics about it. And so now it has its own digital cert that sits on top of that. And so now you can kind of see I'm building a chain of custody of something that should be authorized to run on the device in a specific configuration, in a specific geography, or whatever, however I want to do the attestation piece. Now if I take that and I create the same thing but over here, so that I have two examples of two things that need to talk together. Now, before I establish that TLS connection between them and that tunnel that I'm going to communicate those API requests, each one can TLS and look at the provenance of the other device. So now I'm no longer doing like a system account and a role-based access. I'm literally saying, these specific unique things that I expect you to have all the way until we establish the TLS tunnel. Now that we establish the TLS tunnel, now I have my comms up. Now I can exchange data back. that's just a fundamental way that we can approach highly assured data centric security. And the nice thing about this is the CDNs have been around for a while, which means that legacy stuff, this isn't a greenfield only, this is something that you can go back and legacy retrofit. Things that have TPMs in them, anything, right? So, I don't know what your first TPM was, but you can look back over your legacy stuff and snapshot lines for all that new stuff, and you can do this so that both parts of your enterprise can actually participate in this mutually TLS environments in which we're verifying that authentication. So that's the very first step. No more secret sharing, no more interception, no more impersonation. Because an adversary, if you think about it, would have to capture the manufacturing process. So whatever manufacturing, Dell, HP, whatever you're using, right, you have to capture that process to tamper with the actual manufacturing certificate. You have to tamper, you have to somehow simulate the TPM, which is at a quantum weight level, and you have to know what it was beforehand. You would have to know how to generate that exact quantum weight that's in there that generated that first root identity. You would have to know the unique characteristics of the Kubernetes cluster that you did, and then you would have to know the unique characteristics of the workload. So you have to capture that entire process to impersonate it. What that does is it sets us up in two ways. It allows me to say, okay, if I have a device, the two main sort of threat surfaces on it, I have a device, it goes disconnected. So we're talking edge. It goes disconnected, it reconnects. Do I let it back on and start interacting with any of my stuff? Today, there's no mechanism for whether or not you can determine whether or not it's been tampered with. In this particular framework, this particular approach to this, if the adversary captured my cluster and above and put it on their hardware, the provenance would be wrong. The hashes would be different, it would be valid. If the adversary put their own stuff on my hardware, like an advanced persistent threat, again, the root identity, it would attest, the hashes would be invalid. So now I can go through that same MTLS every time I disconnect, reconnect, and go through that before I establish the connection, but it also allows me to reclaim assets that necessarily shouldn't be killed because they go through and they prove that they have been tampered with, even if they've been offline for an hour, 2 hours, 5 hours, this type of thing. It also allows me to kill instantly things that immediately have an invalid hash. And so it allows me a great amount of flexibility for doing that sort of attestation between any number of devices. Now the nice thing about this is because this is all math, it means that I don't have a sysadd. I don't have to create accounts. I don't do any of this stuff. It can be a completely automated process about how to derive that. The reason that's important is because if I was to spin out 1,000 drones or 1,000 agents that need to work together, they have the provenance all the way up to their workload, and then they have unique characteristics about their workload that would generate their cert on top as the sort of final piece. Why that's good is because it means that at a granular level, I can get down to any specific process. So instead of saying this app can call this thing, it's saying in this app it does this thing, and this is the only process that's authorized to call that API. I can attest it all the way up, and then I can lock down the single process that can actually make the call. That means no sideways. So a hacker gets on, so a nation state actor, whatever, gets on there, tries to move sideways, what are you going to do? You only have one process that's authorized to do it, and it has its own unique identity that has to be attested with its unique characteristics. So you're basically frozen in place. It eliminates that particular piece. The other thing is, the digital certs themselves, while they are root certificates to the physical characteristics, all the way up, the chain, when you actually engage in a session, they're actually ephemeral. So that means you can set 1 hour windows. Every time I conduct a new session, or if I want to do it on time-based every hour, it generates a brand new ephemeral cert that is used in the attestation, but it's derived from the root level cert. That means that the adversary captured that ephemeral cert, what are you going to do with it? Because your time window either ran out or that session is finished and you can no longer use it anymore. So it eliminates the store down the later problem that we have with quantum computers coming and potentially breaking large prime numbers and getting after our traditional security pieces or additional encryption pieces. And the interesting thing about the retrofitting of this is you can look at existing workloads and establish that baseline of just up through the TLS. Now the nice thing about this is that the agility for it though, because we're talking about complete software encryption, it means that I also can do very, very exquisite things with it. Meaning that if I have a policy engine that can define a granular level, say attribute level of elements, and I can correspond labels to that, and those labels can be corresponded to specific different symmetric keys. It means that at data level, I can encrypt individual data elements differently, which means that now if I enter into Coalition, Five Eye, any of these mission partners, I'm not necessarily, what is the safeguard that, say, CES, or going through a process proxy. What are they giving you? What do you, right now, what happens is you go through it, sanitize it, doesn't have anything sensitive, go ahead and send the thing through, right? Or, you know, roughly, I know it's an oversimplification, but in this case, what it means is that I'm on an island, you're on an island, we set up an ad hoc network and we need to share, but I don't want to share all the sensitive things at a, you know, SDI level with you, but I need to share some things because you're my Five Eye partner and we're out in the middle of nowhere and we have no reach back. So now, because in your policy, you have specific Five Eye keys, I have specific Five Eye keys, and I have no foreign keys, and I have to save my no foreign partner over here, it means that I can send out on our little private network, but everybody has only the encryption keys that can decrypt the elements at their sensitivity level, even though we're on a single information plane. And so these are the types of policies in the future of looking at it from a data-centric security perspective rather than a role-based access and user identity. Because a user identity, you would have to reach back somewhere, you'd have to have some sort of federated process, you'd have to have some sort of, you know, piece that would allow you to know whether that person is really that person or somebody has taken, the enemy has, you know, eliminated that person and taken those personal effects like a cap card and, you know, fingerprint ID or something off that, and now suddenly you have access to the system and inside the information sharing. In this particular way, it's very, very different fundamentally about how that control is done. So that's the genesis of the talk. Lots of jump off points there because you can imagine all types of workloads. So if you look at things like, you know, how would an LLM function, how would a machine learning model work, right? Those things also have unique characteristics, entropy, things that you could generate off those. Data sets that they were, you know all the way back to when the model was created, what sort of data sets were that particular model was trained off of, and use as the input to its particular digital identity, how you derive its particular digital cert. And so that allows you a great amount of flexibility because that's a whole lot more than the adversary would have to capture in order to spoof or in order to impersonate those type of workloads. That's it. That's all I have. I know it's pretty short, but that's the genesis of it. I mean, if you guys have specific questions.